Good people of San Francisco, please welcome to the stage W. Kamau Bell.
Good evening, San Francisco. Welcome to Kamau Right Now. Thank you. This is the special W. Kamau Bell's mom is in the house. Are you here, Ma? Are you here? Oh, there she is, right there. She's right there. So if you don't like the show, you have to deal with her. Get ready, everybody. She will find you on Facebook, she will friend you, and then she will read you. That's what's gonna happen. I'm W. Kamau Bell, and tonight we're gonna do what we do. We're gonna have some conversations and get into everything that's happening right now in the world and in our lives. Sometimes these conversations on the show get awkward. Prepare for that. Like on the last episode, we had a Trump supporter on, and it was pretty awkward until we bribed him not to vote for Trump. Yeah, that's right, yes. Yes. At least as far as he told us. How do we bribe him? Of course, we use gummy worms and E40 CDs. Of course, that's what you do. So when you go to Thanksgiving and you have a lot of awkward conversation, take some gummy worms and some E40 CDs, everybody. That's how it goes. We have a really great show tonight. I'm happy. First of all, give it up for the JCCSF, everybody, for letting us do the show here. Yes. I have seen a lot of shows here. I've been here. I've seen lots of things in this room right here. I've been all this place. This is the place every time I come here, I go, huh, maybe I should become Jewish. That's how nice this place is for people listening at home. It's like, huh, Judaism, do you say? Yeah. Free Wi-Fi. I think that's a reason to convert. My guest tonight on this awesome show, we have host of the podcast and the column Dear Prudence, Mallory Ortberg, everybody. Give it for Mallory Ortberg. Ortberg, my pronunciation. Next guest on the panel, we have retired California Superior Court Judge Ladoris Cordell. Give it up for Judge Ladoris Cordell. Judge Cordell would be a great judge show on TV, wouldn't it, though? That just sounds like it's already on TV. And our first return guest, although his tweets seem to make every episode we've had of Kamau Right Now, give it up for Kasim Bentley, everybody. Comedian Kasim Bentley. One of my favorite comics, Kasim Bentley. And then later, we're gonna have a segment we call The Awkward Talk with W. Kamau Bell. We're gonna have probably the most awkward talk you can have at a Jewish community center. You know, where to get the best kugel in San Francisco, right? Is that how it works? People are like, no, that's not it. Oh yeah, you're right. And since this has come out right now, we wanna know what's going on with you right now, with you in the audience here at the JCCSF, with people online, listening on the radio, on Twitter. Maybe you have a question for one of our guests tonight. Maybe you don't wanna talk about, maybe you, want to talk about the elections, because I sure don't. We also want to know good stuff, too. Cat pictures are okay. Whatever you got for us, send it to us. Tweet to us at Kamau Right Now, at Kamau Right Now, using the hashtag Kamau Now, KAMAUNOW. That's how I get people to spell my name correctly. So, in fact, to give you a sense of what's happening online and what we do here, let's introduce the person who will be carefully sorting through all your wonderful social media reactions. Please give it up for our tweet wrangler, Becca Hoekstra over here, everybody. Becca Hoekstra.
Hi, everyone.
Can you give people an example of what we might be talking about?
Yeah, so what we're looking for, I mean, like, here's one that's super great. This is from at Lizzie Halstead. Finally potty trained my three-year-old. Huge victory. No more diapers. My glamorous reality.
Oh, that is a huge victory. Give it up for that kid being potty trained at three. You people without kids don't know. I got two kids. Leaving the house without a bag of everything, that's amazing. We can just leave without taking like a whole bag of clothes and diapers. And oh my God, it's like I'm free again. I love my kids. And as you may have noticed earlier, there's a man with a great mustache wandering through the crowd collecting your audience cards. That's our audience emissary. Give it up for Jeremy Dalmas, everybody. Jeremy Dalmas.
Hi, Kamau.
Jeremy, is there anything you've heard exciting from our audience so far?
Yes, I've already picked out a card because I like rebels. This person says, I snuck in wine. And they have a scared emoji.
Whoa. Somebody's gonna get a little lit during Kamau Right Now. We'll figure out where the best heckling's coming from. That's where the wine snuck in. I wonder if they did you. I guess I can't ask you a question because then you'll know where you are. But I just wonder, was that a financial matter or just because you like to be naughty? You know what I mean? We'll talk later. Oh, right, there you go. Yeah. San Francisco still keeping it freaky. I appreciate that. Got to keep it weird in San Francisco with all you tech people taking over and ruining it and making me move. All right, here we go. Happier in the East Bay. So take that, everybody. Wow, it's already gotten awkward. Look who knew. I knew. Gentrification always makes it awkward in front of white people. Okay, here we go. What? Yeah, I don't want to talk about the election, but let's talk about it a little bit. I don't know. I know there's people here on all sides, from Hillary to Jill Stein. I get it. You're all in the room. All sides are represented. All sides of the left of the political spectrum. I just can't. I've had too much. I don't know. I just feel like if we actually had a thing on the ballot that said, you know, just why don't we just give Obama 4 more years and start this whole process over, right? Yeah, just we didn't try again, you know. Just, you know. I mean, although I do admit the one thing I'm excited about with Hillary Clinton potentially being the president is that I get to say to both my daughters, like, yeah, that's how it works with presidents. Sometimes the president's a black guy, sometimes it's a woman. That's just how it works. That's how it works. Although at this point, I can't imagine we have to do the debates and stuff. Exactly, I know, I don't even want to see it. Anybody else like me, you just want to be induced into a medical coma and wake up during the inauguration just like, oh, look at this. Oh, look who won, oh, interesting. Bernie Sanders, how did that happen? Holding the head of Donald Trump. That's amazing. What's in his other hand? All of Hillary's emails. Wow. All right. President Bernie, here we go. Welcome to Kamau Right Now. Give yourselves a round of applause, everybody. We have got some amazing guests to help us talk about what's going on in the world right now. My first guest is making his second appearance on Kamau Right Now. I think Facebook was built for this dude, and his tweets keep appearing in the show Kamau Right Now. Please welcome one of my favorite comedians of all time, period. Comedian Kasim Bentley, everybody. Kasim Bentley. My next guest is the co-founder of The Toast and the current host of the podcast Dear Prudence at Slate.com, which I appeared on with my friend Hari Kondabolu. Please welcome Mallory Ortberg, everybody. Mallory, give her up.
Yeah.
My last guest is a former police auditor. That sounds hard. For the city of San Jose, California, that sounds harder. A retired judge from the Superior Court of California and the first black female judge in Northern California, we are honored to bring to the stage Judge LaDoris Cordell, everybody. Give it up for Judge Cordell. Thank you. Judge Cordell, you're just one of the coolest people I know. Let me just say that right off.
I'm very cool. but actually, Kamau, when I was on the bench for 20 years, you know, judges, we have certain rules. We can't act out like Judge Judy does, all that crazy stuff. We cannot do that. So once I retired, it was like I was unleashed. So I can be who I am. And I'd love for folks to follow me on Twitter, at Judge Cordell.
Look at that, saying get my followers up. Yes. So let's find out what's going on with you all right now before we talk about what I'm thinking about right now, which is probably what we're all thinking about. Kasim Bentley down there.
Hey, how you doing, man?
I'm doing good, man. So your Facebook page is like it's like a moist mushroom of a place. It's just lots of things growing.
Wait, can you explain that? That graphic is, are you like a super Mario mushroom, or are we talking like?
Like you know, you go to the forest and you lift up a log and there's just stuff growing. That's your Facebook page. Just lots. It's a dark place.
So
with
fungus.
A lot of,
it sounds fungus, like yes. Something horrible that might get. Okay.
It's not always horrible. Sometimes you're like, oh, I can eat that. Sometimes it's all right.
Okay. For the people that don't know, this is what happens. I get invited on and I feel good and he assassinates my self-esteem. Then I go home and cry in a shame ball. Right. Then I get 20 more Twitter followers and I feel okay. Right. So it's live, or as the kids say, it's lit. All
that's right?
Right.
So you are my connection to pop culture.
Okay.
Summer's over now, tell me, what was for you the song of the summer?
Okay, this for everyone here. It's, you know, there's sometimes there's a song that just takes over. You can't stop it. It's like a fungus. You know what I mean? And the song for me was a song like "Ooh," or if you know, it's called "Ooh." It's like Young M.A., right? And the song is amazing because Young M.A. is a rapper from Brooklyn. She's like 21, 22 years old. The amazing thing, but the song is just, if you're in a club or if you're in the street or you're anywhere that sells drugs, it's an amazing song. It's crazy. And
you described where this audience hangs out regularly right here.
Yeah, he knows what I'm talking about. The guy
the
in the
regular,
blue tie knows what I'm talking about. It's like, and so the beautiful thing about the song is because usually you think that, the thing about it's amazing about her is that she's a young, like she's a stud. She's a black stud, right? LGBTQ, all right? And you, before in hip hop, you would never have seen this. You know, because in the world of hip hop, you'd always been rumored that someone was maybe, if a woman rapper was, you know, out there, you'd be like, is she a lesbian? This song, this is the, you know, it'd be Queen Latifah or the Brat.
Whoa. Like, don't ruin my black street cred by outing people on the Kamau Right Now.
I'm sorry. The thoughts and opinions of Kasim Bentley have nothing to do with Kamau Bell or his afro. All right? So, but here's the thing, is that it's a great song, and it's a big statement because I did, like, she's hit the song, everyone's loving it, and this has been little mention or any kind of weird controversy about it, and that's the beautiful thing that's happening right now in hip-hop, is that hip-hop is probably growing up, you know what I mean? It's probably due to social media, you know, the fact that back in the 90s or the 80s, you didn't have enough barbershops, so you didn't have people talking about it with different opinions, but now, because Facebook, Twitter, everything, and Instagram, Snapchat, if you have an iPhone that works, so Samsung doesn't work well, Snapchat, it doesn't work there, is that now we just able to take it in and say, hey, this is what's happening, I'm not gonna sit here and put up this great, crazy fight. You know, even though when you get on Twitter, you do get some of these, like, you do get, like, hotep black people, and, like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, see, that's the problem, brother. See, that's what they're doing. They're going to let her out there, and that's what makes...
You're going to have to define what a hotep black person is for 90% of this audience.
I didn't know. I'm sorry, I didn't look. I'm sorry, I keep looking at you. I'm like, they understand.
It's not. This is not the NAACP SF. This is the JCC SF.
Okay, for the people who follow social media.
I just want to ask before you take a breath. Do you two know what a hotep black person is, Ladore? Judge Cordell, do you know?
I'll take a pass on that.
Okay. Mallory, do you know what, as the representative white person on the panel, do you?
I do.
Okay, all right.
But I'm going to let you explain it.
You see?
I'm not gonna tackle it.
That's a good call, Mallory. I'm gonna
sit right here in my lane.
Okay.
I love how you act like there's just lawyers in the audience ready to sue you or something, or someone from, like a hotep, like when you're on Twitter, you have Black Twitter. That's a community on part of Twitter that represents the concerns, all the lifestyle, the aesthetics of being Black. Hotep Black people are still a part of Black Twitter, but they're like the crazy uncle, you know what I mean? Like the ones that, the uncle that went to NAM, you know what I mean, kind of stuff. The one that has some off, like the theories go well, but then some people on hotep Black Twitter just go crazy, you know what I mean? Like if on any given day on hotep Twitter, somebody will say, you know, if you really harness your energy, you can use your melanin to shoot out rays of lightning, you know what I mean? And you're like, oh, okay, I'm not following you anymore, right? Because you're crazy. You live in a big beach house in Santa Barbara on crazy, you know what I mean? So like, you had people, the controversy was, like, saying that, you know, what does it mean when you have a young lesbian rapper having this hit song, you know, and she's just out here, and what does it represent for the community, you know? Will she be used as this new figurehead and whatnot? But it's beyond that. It's just beautiful to understand that we have to have everyone be represented, you know? And the great thing about her, just like people like Young Thug, there's just this idea that we're finally growing up and not letting sexuality hold us back, you know?
I think that's a good show. Do we have a picture of Young Thug we can show right there? That's
oh,
a
yeah.
Young,
look at him. He looks like a really sassy lampshade, you know what I mean? I love it. I know there's some people listening, my friends or my former friends listening. I know they're going to hate it, but it's like we have to get to a point.
What you're saying is that the younger generation, the millennials, the gender lines are more fluid, and so those people are coming up doing their thing, and there's not as much being caught up on like, well, what does that mean?
Yeah.
If you're doing that, yeah. So,
I mean,
yeah.
The bigger issue about if anyone knows Young Thug is not what he's wearing, it's like, what is he saying? You know what I mean? Because he sounds like cursive, you know what I mean? It don't even make no sense, you know?
Well, thank you, Kasim, for the Song of the Summer update. Give it up for Kasim Bentley, everybody.
Hey.
Judge Cordell.
Yes, come on.
So what does one do after retiring from 20 years in the criminal court system? What's going on with you right now?
Well, what's going on with me right now is I just came off of two big projects. One was chairing a commission investigating the jails in Santa Clara County after the beating death of a mentally ill inmate by some guards. And then being a part of a commission here in San Francisco looking into the racist texting scandal involving 15 San Francisco police officers. So got that stuff done, issued our report. So now,
I didn't hear the word I retired, and I didn't hear the words beach or
not yet.
Yoga
not yet.
Or
getting there.
Okay.
But what I'm doing now is thinking about 20 years of judging, and I'm writing a memoir, a very personal one about what it's like to sit on a bench and be the first African American woman on the bench in Northern California for 20 years, and I'm now taking a look back at what I did and the cases I presided over. And so I'm writing this book to give information. I think it'll be entertaining, but at the same time, I'm also writing it to do some penance because I was part of a system that continues to be broken, and I'm talking specifically about the criminal justice system. And even though I was very well-intentioned, I was still a part of it. And I want to put all that out there. I want to do penance by writing this book in a hope of getting the system somehow better. It's broken, it's really broken, and I know it having been in it firsthand. So that's what I'm working on. So I hope within the next year I can have this memoir out. So
thank you, thank you very much. Does it have a title?
It doesn't have a title yet. I had one idea, and that was and when I presided in court, when the lawyers or the litigants wanted to speak, I had this rule, and it's the rule of the three Bs. Be clear, be brief, be seated. So I'm thinking about possibilities. So we'll see.
That's a good, I like that one. Yeah, that's better than the Judge Judy P book, whatever it was, yeah. Whatever her title was. Nobody knows that? Don't pee on my leg and tell me it's raining.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Judge Judy, yeah.
I like yours better. Although hers seemed to have worked out well for her. So Mallory Ortberg, you've been tweeting a lot lately about a movie and a particular scene in the movie.
I sure have.
And we're on radio and there's FCC guidelines. I'll just say that as we go into this.
Cool. I will choose my words super carefully. I am obsessed right now with the movie Don't Breathe. I'm going to do my best not to give you too many spoilers, but if you're very interested in seeing the movie Don't Breathe, plug your ears right now. It's billed as this very straightforward home invasion movie, and then in the
straightforward middle, home invasion movie.
You know, okay. When you it's like these like bad teens are invading the home of this like intense Gulf War veteran, which was weird, by the way, to notice like, oh, we're not doing scary Vietnam veterans in movies anymore.
Oh,
like we've moved on. So now like,
is that a good thing? Is it good for us?
It was just like an odd moment. It was like a passing of the baton. So they invade his home and it's like very intense. And then like 2/3 of the way through the movie, there's this super bananas at home in vitro fertilization scene. I'm trying so carefully to choose
I
my
know,
words.
It's just like,
and it's the best thing
at,
I've let's ever
say it,
seen.
At home in vitro fertilization
it's
scene.
It's definitely
all right.
not like it's not following best practices. And there's just this like loving close-up of what is like a mason jar's worth of semen. Can I say semen on the air?
Well, we've said it twice, now. So there we go.
And it is so, like, you look at it and you're like, that's a jar of semen. Ah, and there's like an intense close-up of what I thought was like a CGI sperm, like one to really let you know, like, this is semen. But it's not. I went and saw it again, and it's a single CGI pubic hair to let you know it's semen.
I'm looking at the producer of the show right now, and his head was in his hands, like, oh, there we go.
But it was
they
just
invited us to the JCCSF. We told him we had a... Here we go.
Judge but it was just so perfect, and
Judge
I realized...
Judge Cordell's face this whole time has been pretty excellent, too. Just like,
I am sorry. I will give you that. I am sorry. But I'm not going to stop, but I'm sorry. But what was so perfect is it was just like, I feel like we've had so many horror movies, like from Aliens to Teeth, that are just like, oh, birth is terrifying. Like, the vagina scares me. And now we're getting just some, like, good old-fashioned semen anxiety. And I think that's so great. I just think that's really nice.
Yay! If you just tuned in, I'm W. Kamau Bell. And I've been speaking with Kasim Bentley, Mallory Ortberg, and Judge Ladores Cordell. If you just tuned in, you're very confused. This is Kamau Right Now on KALW, live from the JCCSF. That's right, that's where we are, in San Francisco. So this week, what I've been thinking about are two things. One is Colin Kaepernick. Oh, there, I think I heard a boo. Which brings me to my second thing, most Americans' inability to have two conversations at once. Football and justice, I don't know how to do that. And it's all symbolized by ex-San Francisco 49er Jerry Rice and two tweets. So Jerry Rice's first tweet was a few weeks ago. He says, all lives matter, which a black guy saying all lives matter, saying, I don't want to eat barbecue anymore that's any tasty. I want to get my barbecue from Safeway from now on. He says, all lives matter. So much going on in this world today. Can we just all get along? Oh, no, we learned that in the 90s. That's not going to happen. He says, Colin, I respect your stance. Do you? But don't disrespect the flag. And then, clearly, every black person in Jerry Rice's life who he respects came and came for him, as we say in the black community, got him. And then just yesterday, I support Kaepernick for bringing awareness for injustice. As Americans, we all have rights. I'm hoping we all come together. Hashtag solution. He invented his own hashtag because Black Lives Matter wouldn't fit at that point, I guess. And so, you know, this is the Bay Area, this is a national news story, but this is the Bay Area, and this comes from us, and we all are talking a lot about Colin Kaepernick. Can you show a picture of Colin Kaepernick? There he is. Yeah. Wait a minute. That's a picture of Colin Kaepernick in his 49ers jersey from last year. Show a recent picture of Colin Kaepernick. There we go. With his giant afro. He looks like he's throwing that football for justice. Look at that. I love that. It looks like a blaxploitation movie right there. Who is the man who kneels for his brother, man? Cap! Damn right.
Very good. So Kamau, why do we even play the national anthem at sports events? What are we doing? Yeah.
Good question, Judge.
I don't understand, sports? I mean, the U.S. Open.
Like they do before plays.
Yeah, right.
Before we start Romeo and Juliet.
It's ridiculous. I just think it's ridiculous. I think that, yeah. Using the national anthem at sports events, I mean, if we take that away, we can get on and deal with the sports.
Yeah.
I appreciate what Kaepernick is doing.
Yes.
I absolutely do. And I think it took a lot of courage for him. Because that man has taken some heat from doing this.
Yeah, because let's be clear. He's not the star quarterback anymore. So he's not like the Tom Brady of the team Tom Brady can do whatever he wants to and often does with his Trump caps on. He's also, football contracts aren't guaranteed. So he can be cut at any time and not get his money. So it's
But we know that what's going to happen.
What's going to happen, Kasim?
They're going to figure out some way to cut him. He's going to go to another crap team. And then, like, Oh, did it? I'm sorry. I didn't get the realness right now. No, but I was, when you talk to guys that play football, like I got a friend that plays NFL, and I got a guy that taught college football, and we were just talking about this like barbershop talk, and the way it happens right now, they're putting up the good face, 49ers puts up all this money, everything, everyone's protesting, but it's like that, there was that story about how all the owners and people from the NFL were like, they were just talking about him and any other player that sits there and protests. You know, I hate to say this, but I think that he's doing a really brave thing, but it's hopefully that we can support him when he's playing in the Canadian Football League or something.
You know what I mean? And he's like, see if those Canadian football jerseys
or whatever, what is out there. But it's one of those things, right? And I hope that other players aren't afraid to lose endorsements or their status with some teams just so they can fight for justice, you know?
Yeah.
So
I mean, I think it's going to be interesting because, you know, the NFL has a lot of black players, but the power in the league is not with the players in the NFL. It's with the owners. But we're a few weeks away. Yes, we're a few weeks away from the NBA, where the power is really in the players' hands.
Yeah.
And I think even the players, and I've heard read into this a little bit. In the NFL, there's nothing that says you have to stand for the anthem. In the NBA, it's written into the players' collective bargaining agreement. So you have to stand or suffer fines. So it's going to be really interesting what happens because the NBA is a more activist league.
Yeah.
You know, LeBron James can't do all that, like wear the I Can't Breathe shirt and pose in the hoodie. And then this season when the NBA starts, just bam-ba-dam, standing tall, he's got to do something.
Yeah, but they're not going to mess with LeBron. See, I really believe that he could do that, and I think he would be fine. I think there would be a huge uproar if they decided to do that. So I just think as long as the national anthem is there, it really does take courage for these players to sit down or kneel down for justice. And I think we need to give them as much support as possible.
Yes, yes. Yeah. And the other thing that has revealed itself, and I think this, I don't know if Colin had this in mind, but it also revealed the super racist third verse of the national anthem. The third verse of the national anthem has the word slave in it, and it rhymes with the word grave, and I'll let you make the connection with how that goes about. That's the third verse of the national anthem. So, I mean, I feel like that's the bigger question. Like, why this song is the anthem at all, is the question. There's been a lot of songs written since then. You know. I'm for Ray Charles' version of America the Beautiful at every, specifically his version.
We don't do Kendrick, It's All Right.
There we go. Kendrick Lamar, We Gonna Be All Right. then the white players are kneeling. Wait a minute, I don't know about this. And this comes out of the fact that right now we are living it, you know, Colin Kaepernick starts this protest a month ago, and to say that we need to talk about black lives in this country and the police officer and police officers and unjustified killing. And in the last week, there's been three suspicious killings. There's Terrence Crutcher, who's 40, a father of four. His car stalled in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and he was shot in the back while he had his hands up walking. Keith Lamont Smith, 43, Charlotte, North Carolina. He was shot in his car. Family said he was reading a book. Police said he had a gun, but North Carolina is an open carry state, so you can't actually have a gun unless you're black. And then there's Tyree King, 13, Columbus, Ohio, had a BB gun, and the autopsy suggests he was shot while running away. And that's just been in the last few days. I mean, so, you know, I feel like the one thing about this is that whatever Kaepernick is doing, which is great, at some point, do you have to raise the stakes on this? Do you have to go from, like, not standing for the anthem to, like, I always think about Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali lost 3.5 years of his prime that he gave up for his beliefs. You know what I mean? Is there a point at which that athletes do something like that, where, like, if LeBron James says, I'm not playing again until X, Y, and Z, I think X, Y, and Z will happen by later that day.
Well, we already know that there are football players, a team, and I'm blanking out on the university, where there had been a lot of racist incidents.
University of Missouri.
Right, and the players said, we're not playing.
All of them.
And guess what? Everybody gave them what they wanted. You know, the president got to step in, out the door, right?
Yes, that's a legal term, got to step in, right?
You know, so a lot of it is it's really the power of the people, but I will tell you, these shootings have just left me feeling empty, just empty. So it's further than rage, further than anger, just an emptiness now. And I really want us to start thinking about what it is that we really need to be doing here. So we've been talking about all the rage, by the way, now is implicit bias training. People need to understand that bias is an officer. Okay, but I'm looking at
that was
at
liberal
all
white
these...
people's like, could we have a new word for racism?
Yeah.
That one hurts my feelings a little bit. can we have something that sounds just a little bit like you know, just something that I could do and not feel so bad about it? I wasn't racist. I was just implicitly biased.
There you go. And that's really been. And I want us, we really have to start thinking outside the box on this. Mm-hmm. About we're taking this box, which is policing, and we're saying, this is what we have. Well, maybe we can have something else. Mm-hmm. Maybe we should just start thinking about what else we could have patrolling our communities. Do we always have to have police? I think we need to start thinking about it. I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, no, and I think, too, it's a lot to... that something as mild as sitting or kneeling during the national anthem like causes so many of us white people to freak out mm-hmm. when like in 1 week, you know, three people have been killed.
That we know, but that we're talking
that
about.
That we know of and that we're talking about, yeah. whose names we know is really like speaks to like the power of white fragility to like silence and hurt people. And I think it's not just on people like Colin Kaepernick and other people to say something, but it's not just athletes' responsibilities as public figures, like it's on us, especially people who know or are related to police officers or people in positions of power, to take a look at like, why are they so armed and so quick to shoot?
Yeah.
Why are we doing that?
Like, yeah. I always love it when, I love that phrase, white fragility, because I think that's where a lot of this swings around, is white people like, I just don't want to think about bad things.
Well, it's like
I just want to watch the football game and see guys get concussions. Can I just do that, please?
It's like you were saying a minute ago with, like, we really flip out when people say that you just said something racist. Like, we really tend to lose it, because it's like, that's as bad as having something racist happen to you. It's like, no, it's definitely not. But we act like it is.
Yeah, absolutely. Kasim?
I mean, the thing about this whole situation with the shootings and the Kaepernick is I do look for people like you and other entertainers and other people in sports to stand up. But something I always think about is these corporations that back these athletes in major league sports, where you don't have people saying like, hey, we see the problem and we're gonna pull out from you, Major League Baseball, we're gonna pull out from you, NFL, and see, because that's a lot of times like comes down to, I think that's where a lot of time players won't speak up because they don't want to lose their Nestle contract or whatnot. Mm-hmm. But someone from Nestle has to say that it's crazy right now. It's gonna just keep on getting crazy until something happens. And you know, your point about white fragility, which is beautiful. I'm gonna get that tattooed on my arm, I think, right there. It's right there. Is that?
You just point to it, and a white person goes, did you just call me a racist? Point to you're feeling this right now.
He's like, Oh, okay, yeah. WF, all right, I got it right there.
I think old English script would be good for a white fragility tattoo.
Can't argue with a tattoo.
I think you just wanna open a store called White Fragility, you know what I mean? See what's going on here. I had a half off sale on White Fragility today. It was a white sale, it was real nice. Right there. Is that, but this is a time, like that thing Hassan talked about, like this is a time for white people, like, and while allies and people are new to these issues, is to stand up, whether it's through a hashtag, whether it's protesting, whether it's just having a conversation. We understand what's happening, we understand the stake, and we understand it's gonna get worse if we don't, as a collective, come together and speak up. Don't be shocked when it's at your door, you know, because we're at a point where it's like a pressure cooker. You know, we feel like the country is starting to really boil up, and the people that are being marginalized, there's going to be enough people to say we're not taking anymore, and who knows what's going to happen. I know it could sound wild coming from me, but that's what I feel.
No, you with that beard, you look like a guy who would say that, yeah.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. Sometimes I don't have a mirror in my house. I don't know what it looks like right now. I usually think I look like a teddy bear, but right there. But no, it's one of those times where I do say, if any people out here listening that are white, like, it's time to just be a part of change, and I think that it's
yes. It's time we check in. Give it up for our panel, everybody. We're gonna keep them here for a little bit. Yeah. It's time we check in on what's happening with our social media desk, with what's happening on Twitter, and you in the live audience. Please get up for our tweet wrangler, Becca Hoekstra, everybody. Becca Hoekstra.
Hey.
On our last show, in the after party, which you can only hear on the podcast, we were talking a lot about these Donald Trump statues that went up all over San Francisco. And we got a really thoughtful comment on our Facebook page from Shane Brody, who held a protest. He's a self-identified fat trans man. And so he did this protest where he stood in the same spot as the statue with his body, which very much resembled those statues that were put up in a way to shame Donald Trump. And really, it's just trying to talk about, like, really, like, body comments. That's the best we can do to insult someone.
Yeah. Is that really the problem with Donald Trump?
Yeah.
How his body is shaped? Is
yeah.
that really where it all falls apart? If only yeah. his body was shaped differently.
Uh-huh,
yeah.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Is Shane, we invited Shane tonight. Is Shane here? There's Shane right
Yay.
There. Shane Brody.
Yay.
Hold on, Shane. I'm coming, Shane.
Whoa.
You're getting a hug, Shane. Hopefully you want a hug. Thank you, Shane. Thank you for doing this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Oh, that's what we're talking about. Shane Brody, everybody. What else we got? Can we top that? I don't think we can top that.
That was such a beautiful moment, man.
Yeah. I feel like the sad part was how long it took me to get back on the stage. It just sort of, everybody had to watch, like, he's a big dude for to be that lackluster with his movement.
We still have some more beautiful stuff. This is from Aaron R. We ask people to tweet us like good things. So he's raising his hashtag 3Kings to break stereotypes and be the leaders of the future. And it's three beautiful, beautiful brown babies just laying on the floor and smiling.
That's a beautiful picture of that dad and his three brown kids. What did you say? My producer just said something to me, and I'm going to ask him what he said, even though we're not supposed to do it that way, but he thought I could hear him over all the clapping. Give it up for Try the Pie, everybody!
Hey.
Try the Pie! Again, I'm W. Kamau Bell, and this is Kamau Right Now on KALW. And also, give it up for our guests, Kasim Bentley, Mallory Ortberg, and Judge LaDores Cordell. Hey. Also, give it up for our tweet wranger, Becca Hoekstra. We'll have the panel back later, so keep those tweets coming at hashtag Kamau Now. All right, so we've heard what's going on Twitter, but let's hear what's happening with the people right here at the JCCSF in San Francisco. Please welcome our audience emissary, the holder of the beautiful mustache, Jeremy Dolmus, everybody, Jeremy Dolmus.
Hi again. So
what's going on in this room, sir?
So this is one where someone made turned lemon into lemonades. Bron says, I'm unemployed and enjoying every minute of it while it lasts.
Is that who's unemployed? Who's the person who wrote that card?
Is Ron.
Ron? Way in the back? That's how unemployed you show up late, sit in the back, you just don't even... What are you doing with your time? Just scream it out.
Nothing.
Man, as a parent with two kids, oh, I envy you so much. What is nothing like? I remember nothing in my 20s. It was so awesome. What else we got out there, Jeremy?
Ike Pinkston. I recently did a hunger strike to protest against police brutality in San Francisco, and it breaks my heart that although it was semi-successful, it took someone dying at the hands of law enforcement for action.
Wait, is this one of the Frisco Five, right? Give it up for the Frisco Five, everybody. We had the Frisco Five on an earlier show. It was way more than semi-successful, as far as you ask me. I believe all these movements are links in a chain, and that was a very powerful link. One more time for the Frisco Five. Thank you. Thanks, Jeremy. And to all you out there, keep your questions and comments coming. We'll do some more in the after party after the show, and we'll have our panel back later on during the show. So if you got something to ask or a comment for them, use the hashtag Kamau Now, KAMAUNOW. the member of the Frisco Five said there was more on the back of the card. Can we read it at the after party? Thank you very much. Give it up, Frisco Five, everybody. I don't want to disrespect. Next time, did you write the word over or continued at the bottom of the card? Okay, all right. So fair enough. I appreciate it. We've all learned a valuable lesson here, haven't we? The Frisco Five keeps teaching us. I appreciate that. We'll read it in the after party, I promise. Now it is time for my favorite part of the show.
Sorry. It's an awkward talk with W. Kamau Bell.
Yeah. Yes. This is the part of the show where we get into the things that are on our mind that we don't always feel comfortable talking about, but seem to have no problem posting about on Twitter with my name attached to them. So look, everybody, I'm just gonna be quite honest and open about this. When the JCCSF invited me here to do Kamau Right Now, I was super excited about it. I've come here for many events. I support the JCCSF. But I immediately knew what I felt like I had to talk about if I was actually doing the thing that I think I'm doing, which is entering into difficult conversations that I think we need to have more often. So I knew what I wanted the awkward talk to be about. We're talking about Israel and Palestine. Obviously, we're not going to solve it right here tonight, but I feel like we have to start having these conversations more often, more out in the open, so that's what we're here to do. And while the JCCSF has allowed us to do this, they also have let us know that this is not number one in their favorite things to do list. So I want to give them a round of applause for letting us do this. We have to, and also just to remind everybody, I am the black guy who went on television and talked to the Ku Klux Klan. So I have some experience with awkward conversations. So my first guest is a member of Jewish Voice for Peace. Please welcome Sydney Levy, everybody. Sydney Levy. Thank you. My next guest is a rabbi at Congregation Emmanuel here in San Francisco. She's also the vice chair of the National Board for Bend the Ark, a Jewish partnership for justice. Please welcome Rabbi Sydney Mintz, everybody. Rabbi Sydney Mintz. Thank you. And also sitting at the social media desk, he just snuck in, is one of my favorite people of all time, period. My ambassador to the Jewish people, one of San Francisco's best and greatest comedian, and my own personal rabbi, Nato Green, everybody.
Shalom. For the purpose of tonight, I would like to be known as Rabbi Sydney Nato Green. Esquire the third.
All right. We have two Sydneys now. We got a third Sydney.
It's some hot Sydney on Sydney action.
All right, Nato, you've probably said enough already. Let's. So first of all, thank you, Rabbi, and thank you, Sydney, which it could be you, Rabbi. But thank you both Sydneys for coming tonight. I appreciate it.
Two Sydneys for the price of one.
That's right. So we know Sydney will be right tonight. That's the first thing we start out with this conversation.
For sure.
So thank you. I know this is a loaded conversation. Like I said, I often have loaded conversations in my life. So this is a new one, but not an exception. I guess I want to start off with the questions, like the meta question, why is it so hard to have a conversation about Israel and Palestine? Why is it, we don't have to have the conversation, but why is it so hard to even think about having the conversation? When we suggested it, it was like, okay. So why is that, why do you think that is?
I think because like any tribe, any family, how many people here have had a difficult conversation with their family, right? So
wow, not that many people. You guys stopped going to Thanksgiving? Is that what happened here?
Yeah, so the Jewish people are a family, we're a tribe, and we actually like having difficult conversations. So I understand for this show, purpose of the show, it's an awkward conversation. There's nothing really awkward about, I think, talking about Israel-Palestine. I think it's challenging.
Okay, all right. I was going to say, nothing awkward about it?
Okay, Sydney disagrees.
Now, Sydney, the first Sydney disagrees with the, or the second Sydney disagrees with the first Sydney.
I mean, I think that the conversations are happening all the time. And in that respect, Sydney, here present, is right. But I think that what's going on is that there are rules that do not allow us to have the conversation. And that's part of the problem. I'll give you a quick example. For example, in this very room, Jewish Voice for Peace, I'm a member of that organization, we had an award ceremony, I don't know, like a good number of years ago. It was called the Olive Branch Awards. A year later, the guidelines for this institution were changed so that we would never be able to rent a space in this institution. And why? Because we talk differently and because we talk about Israel-Palestine in different ways. I'm happy to talk with anybody about Israel-Palestine, but there are rules in certain Jewish institutions that say we are not a tribe, we are not having the conversation, have it elsewhere. And that, I think, is part of the problem.
I don't think anybody says we're not a tribe. We are a tribe that have really
but
different opinions.
But we need to talk, yes, definitely.
And we have to talk about it. And it has to be really difficult. I mean, we have a 4,000-year tradition, which you are familiar with, machloket. Machloket is like really heartfelt disagreement and not walking out the door, but keeping facing one another. And we have tochecha, which is rebuking one another when we think that something is wrong in our community. So I don't think it's okay to turn away from one another when we disagree.
I agree with Sydney.
All right. Nato, how am I doing so far?
You're doing well, Kamau. You can still have Jewish friends.
Thank you. All right.
you can still come to my house for Passover.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I was really concerned about that. Just recently, Israel has been in the news. Last week, the U.S. and Israel agreed to a new military aid deal that will send $38 billion to Israel in the next 10 years. And then today, Obama, who's been an outspoken, has had criticism of Israel, said this to the UN. I think it was earlier this week he spoke to the UN about this situation.
And surely Israelis and Palestinians will be better off if Palestinians reject incitement and recognize the legitimacy of Israel. But Israel recognizes that it cannot permanently occupy and settle Palestinian land.
Now that seems like a simple statement, but I also was like, his Jewish Twitter is going to blow up right now. And so what? How do you feel?
Kamau, Jews can't work in 140 characters. So
oh,
Jewish Twitter has a lot more characters.
Okay.
There is Jewish Twitter, by the way. It's yes. Longer.
Yes, but Twitter is not anti-Semitic. We can get it down to 140. We can.
And we just have to type right to left.
So I think you're right. I think a lot blows up when the President of the United States talks about it, but I think that when it comes to sitting around a table together, a round table, that there any Jew, any non-Jew who understands and accepts that Israel exists, the existence of Israel and the Jewish people and that homeland, is at the table. So I don't think that's a problem. If there's a conversation going on where at the center is the existence of the state of Israel, I think we're all in agreement. I also believe that a lot of Jews in this country, I know most Jews in Israel are very comfortable talking about the occupation, most Jews in this country are getting far more understanding and vocal about the issues with it.
I don't think the issue is the existence of the state of Israel or not. It does exist, but I think that is when we are talking about Israelis and Palestinians, we have to stop talking about the state of Israel and the Palestinians. So if the premise of the conversation is, let's talk about the state of Israel as Jews, and then let's talk about the others who are the Palestinians who may or may not be in the room, then that's not a conversation. That may be a conversation inside of the tribe, which is cute for Passover and it's nice for Rosh Hashanah, but it's not a conversation. A conversation needs to be on equal terms. And that's part of what I want to see. And by the way, this issue of military aid, there are three letters why this conversation is very difficult to have. And this conversation, this what President Obama was saying, is the third letter. One is boycott, B, the other D is divestment, and the third is sanctions. Many parts of the Jewish community don't want to talk about BDS. S is sanctions. S are the Jews that say, we don't want to give more military aid to Israel. We don't want tax dollars to go to Israel when Israel occupies another people. And that's a legitimate conversation that is very hard to have in some institutional Jewish communities. But we have to have it, whether you disagree or not.
I disagree with BDS, but that doesn't mean I'm not in the same tribe with you. We have to be able to
disagree. You're in the same tribe, and we are sitting together. We're Sydney and Sydney.
We're Sydney and Sydney. We disagree.
Well, I feel like we've just turned this into a whole show you guys can tour with. We're Sydney and Sydney. We disagree. Give it up for our panel, everybody. The Awkward Talk. I know we just sort of got into it. We can talk about it in the after party, but I appreciate the JCCSF letting us start this conversation. Thank you, Rabbi Sydney. Thank you, regular Sydney. All right, I want you to help me welcome back our awesome panel. Give it up for Mallory Ortberg, Kasim Bentley, and Judge LaDores Cordell. All right, let's check in again with Becca Hoekstra at the social media desk. Becca, what is Twitter saying about what's going on right now?
We have some interesting conversations about dreads happening, so this is kind of a two-parter. So at May Givens, I'm upset with the federal judge allowing companies to not hire anyone with dreadlocks. So basically it was kind of just determined that, like, if someone has dreadlocks, you can fire them for, like, looking inappropriate work. And that's okay, you can do that.
What?
So, yeah, I know.
Right? Judge Cordell, do something! Wait,
I have
but,
no idea.
But okay, it continues. Oh, Becca's got a hold. This is, here we go, I'm sorry.
Still same conversation. So then at Zedonim was asking, can cultural appropriation contribute to cultural integration, i.e. Marc Jacobs uses of white models wearing multicolored dreads on the runway, which just happened at like the New York fashion show or whatever. And like, I guess not is the answer.
So you can't.
Another good answer would be blowjob sound.
did you see that article by Marc Jacobs?
No, what's
his
the article?
His reasoning for having white people on the runway of dreadlocks, because he's like, well, black women can have white people hair, and it's like, what, are you crazy? It's like, did you fall off the runway? What is wrong with you, man? I love, and it's like, and that coming right afterward is just that, you know how it is when you're on social media, you get like, oh God, I gotta take a break. This
yeah,
is like crazy.
Yeah.
You know.
No, I've often pulled a Kaepernick. I gotta take a knee right now. This is really taking me down. So the first two, you can't wear dreadlocks at what companies? Federal companies?
Yes. It was like, I just.
Are they preparing for President Trump? Was that what's happening?
Yeah, no, I don't know. It's just, apparently it's not in the Civil Rights Act. It doesn't count as racial discrimination, apparently.
So they're saying that Martin Luther King didn't say, I have a dream that black men with dreadlocks will be able to work at any government job they want.
Yeah.
Okay. What else we got on Twitter?
Let's see. This one people want to talk about a lot. At Jerome Spann, you already know what you need to talk about. Charge this quick. What does it say? And it's about the cop who shot Terrence Crutcher. She was already charged. She's also been referred to as, like, she reacted over-emotionally. And, like, you know, that's already coming out.
Yeah,
so.
I did have to say, when I saw that the cop who shot him was a woman that was charged, I was like, oh, so this is weirdly, like, sexism taking the place of racism in some sense. Is that what's happening here? What do you think about this, Judge Cordell?
Well, first of all, she has been charged with first-degree manslaughter. And so she is now, you know, facing criminal charges. You know, there's a big issue, by the way. It's been said that policing would be much better if there were more women in policing. And maybe that's true, and there is some research that does show that women tend to lower the level of use of force. But recent events, and I know of other incidents where I'm not comfortable even, you know, if that's a reform, I'm not comfortable with it because I don't think it's gonna get us where we should be, so.
Yeah, I think any idea that women are somehow naturally more restrained, I mean, we already know there's a really ugly history with white women overreacting to blackness in this country. Like, we're as much a part of that as white men, and I think we don't want to admit it, but, like, it's good that she's been charged. I would like it if more of the white male officers had shot people had also been charged, but, like, she should be charged. It's good. It is the right outcome.
Yeah, I mean, and we also know that you can be charged with something and then walk away from something, you know. I mean, I'm old enough to remember the Rodney King thing, and I thought, you know, and to have seen that tape and go like, well, they got it on tape this time, and we all know how that went down. So, I mean, I think it's just being charged with something.
It's one thing to be charged, next to be convicted, and that has to be a jury or a judge making that decision. And it doesn't often happen.
Yes. Yeah, this is just the first step.
Yeah. Becca, is there anything over there that can take us out of this hole of sadness? No. It's fine if there's not. I can keep digging the hole.
It's still kind of sad. Well, it's different, I guess. At Carla Martin 4147, can a black person support Trump and still be black? I don't know. This person's views.
Well, we're getting some feelings from the audience about that. Funny thing, there's a lot of white people saying no.
Yeah, that seems interesting.
I felt the wind of the nose hitting me in the face.
I know. It's like a Beyonce wind machine. It was so powerful, the wind. Kasim, I'm going to let you take that one. Can a black person support Trump and still be black?
I mean, all right, look. If you're listening at home and you support Trump, I want to make sure you put your ears really close to the speaker. Because I really want you to hear this. All right, I'm going to give you 2 seconds. Are you out your Negro mind?
Oh, I'm so happy you ended that nig with grow. Okay.
And Kamau, who are all those black people? You ever see them standing behind Trump when he's speaking? There's always two or three black. Who are they?
Who are they? They're paid hourly, is what they are.
All right,
then. Here's the thing. I think you can be a black person support Trump, of course, and damn me, I'm a black person. But if you do it, there's one thing about voting for something crazy. But to be publicly supporting it, that's where I go. Look at that. Every time a black person runs for the Republican nomination, Republicans go, yay, for 2 weeks. Then they go, get your crazy butt out of here. Even Republicans don't like black Republicans.
I just want to know.
What'd you say?
Wait.
Hold on. We're almost at the end of the show. We will get to you later in a few minutes. We're almost. Huh? Oh, that's you? Are you voting for Trump? Oh, okay.
All
right. I thought she was like, I am voting for Trump, and I am going to talk. I would have brought you right on stage, Black. But yeah. All right, we have our last tweet before this show ends.
This is one we've gotten before. Hey, Kamau, now, why are all your producers white?
That is a good question. Believe me, sometimes I sit at producer meetings and go, hey, why are all my producers white? Matt, Max, you're the producer, your head producer, Max Jacobs. Why are you guys all white?
Oh, damn. Did you see the nervousness? My fragility.
Awkward.
Yeah.
One of y'all better say y'all Algerian moment. Or something. What's going on?
It's a good question. Why are you guys all white,
we
Max?
We haven't hired anybody new since the start of the show.
Uh-huh.
It's not a good answer, but...
This is a second awkward talk in the show, isn't it?
I'll step aside.
You'll step aside?
Yeah.
You'll step aside for a black person or a person who's not a white person?
Sure.
Here, the way you would really do it, Max, is that you would still do the work. You just give a person of color your money. That's how you'd really do it.
It's fair.
I don't think it's fair to just step aside. I think you got to still do the job, but you just hand your paycheck to Kasim. I think that's how it works.
I will say I felt really weird like starting this job and like starting the Twitter account. I was like, I'm integrating myself into black Twitter almost. And like, why? Why is this my job? This is kind of weird.
And to be totally honest, Becca, there's sometimes you tweet things and then black people go, Kamau, what are you saying? She didn't get out of the black voice right. We're still working on it. I love you, Becca. So I'm like, that's not actually how you use that phrase. Man, this has been the most awkward show we've had. Give it up for Kamau Right Now, everybody. Yeah. That's our show. Yeah. I want to thank our wonderful guests once again, Mallory Ortberg, Kasim Bentley, Judge LaDores Cordell, Rabbi Sidney Mintz, Sidney Levy, and Nate O'Green. Thank you to the JCCSF Hall for hosting us. The Kamau Right Now team is Ted Muldoon, Dan Brandon, James Rollins, Jeremy Dalmas, Becca Hoekstra, Phil Circus, Max Jacobs, and Matt Martin, who's also white! It's the Public Radio! audio problem. Music by Try the Pie. Get over Try the Pie. Come Out Right Now is a white production of KALW. For those in the mostly white audience, stay with us. We've got more coming up. If you're listening on the white radio, you can catch the rest of the white podcast. So go subscribe to Kamau Right Now, right now. I'm Black W. Kamau Bell. Thank you so much, and good night! Our staff could also use more women!
I hear your voice still, so clearly underneath the door to my
Who wants a hug?
Folding in, shaking and grasping at intangible pain.
I'm hugging it out at the end of the show. Oh, thank you, thank you.
This time around,
very much.
Over.
Who else wants a hug? Even white
Pull
people can have them.
Completely in.
Okay, all right, one more.
Back together,
Who else? I'll come to the back. I'm coming. High five. He doesn't feel comfortable with that much black man in his face. Thank you. One more. Here we go. Thank you. Oh, thank you. All right, I'm coming to the back for more hugs. I almost threw a ray past his leg. Oh, here we go. Thank you. All right, guys.
Thank you very much. Try the Pie. Give it up for Try the Pie, ladies and gentlemen. Oh my goodness, give it up for this amazing panel we have here tonight. Do you all want to hear more from Kamau and this amazing panel? We will hear from them.
I gotta go back
just...
up there.
Hey, Kamau.
Thank you. Oops. Keep talking, Phil, sorry.
Okay, hey, wherever you are out there. Give yourself a round of applause. You are an amazing audience. Oh my goodness. Because you came here tonight to the JCCSF, and we have more show for you coming up in just a little bit. But once again, I have to make this appeal. Before you leave this amazing building, please subscribe to our podcast. It is a big deal. Look at this. Look at this guy. Look at what he's doing. All because he wants you to subscribe to Kamau Right Now. And again, writing reviews is a big, big deal for us. It helps us to keep going. This is our 9th show. If you liked what you saw tonight, come to our 10th show, which is actually our 1-year anniversary show, is on October 27th at the Norse Theater in San Francisco. Now that's in collaboration with City Arts and Lectures. And you can go
Who's gonna be on that show?
Oh my goodness. We have Jesse Klein is going to be on that.
The
show.
Head writer of Amy Schumer, inside
the
Amy
head
Schumer?
Writer.
Wow.
Anna Sale is going to be on
Anna
that
Sale
show.
From Death, Sex, and Money?
She's really going to be on the show.
Yay.
Alicia Garza is going to be on
One of the co-founders of Black Lives Matter is going to be on the show.
She's going to be on that show. You do
She
not.
Can take Max Jacobs' job. She can take his paycheck. He can hand
she
her paycheck.
She is all teed up to take Max Jacobs' job. This is going to be.
Not the job, just the paycheck. She's already working hard enough.
Right.
And I'm sure she's underpaid for it.
There are still seats for that, and you really need to see that. I want to thank some people, some volunteers who really helped get the production going tonight. I want to give a big thank you to Jenny Tai, Alex Kamerling, Devin Strolovich, Ashley Ann Krigbaum, Karina Jevons, and Shefali Badia. Oh, and Dan Roth. Give it up for them, please. You know, I'm going to give this mic back to Kasim, but please welcome back W. Kamau Bell.
Thank you. Thank you, Phil. Phil Circus, everybody. So everybody, this is the after party of Kamau Right Now. We're off the air, but we still got good conversations. Like, you want to hear more from the panel, right? Yeah, of course. So we got we have Mallory Ortberg, Cassine Bentley, and Judge LaDoris Cordell, everybody. By the way, Mallory, I just want to compliment you. Your ability to go from semen to white fragility was quite amazing in the show. I've never seen anybody take that dramatic of a turn.
They're both white and fragile substances.
And then right back into it. I didn't even see that coming. It's like, I was like Magic Johnson to your Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. I was like, here you go. That was amazing.
I'm just happy to be here.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. Do we have any more tweets, Becca, that we can talk about or anything else?
We actually do. We got someone fact-checking us kind of for the first time ever, which I'm very excited about.
Uh-oh.
I really hope it's about my thing.
So Christy Dowler telling us more about the national anthem. It played for marketing, started in the 1930s at the Cubs game to get people out of their seats, not for patriotism. So you can...
Wait, what were they marketing? Like getting out of your seat or...
What they're marketing? Here's the thing. They were marketing
like
baseball.
Like we just hate
sitting?
Yeah.
Baseball.
Yeah.
Quite boring baseball, actually.
Right.
So they're like, people are sitting in the stands like, here we go, watching 3 hours of this nonsense until black guys can play in the NBA. And then finally, they played the anthem and people, that was to get people energized for the game. I don't know if I read the same article.
Wait, so they were originally playing the national anthem to like... That was the end goal, just like, we better go to a baseball game because after an hour and a half, we can hear a song?
Yes. No, before it's to get people, you show up at the game and you sit in your seat like, this is already boring. Oh, the anthem, yay! I suddenly think I care about baseball. I don't like baseball, is what I'm trying to say.
This is why you need black people working in your office, you know what I mean? Because that's this idea like, hey, we're going to play the national anthem at a baseball game. If there was one black guy working off, it's like, hey, before y'all do that, can I talk to you for a minute? The song is, I did some research.
I read the next verse.
they can fast forward to the last one. Wait, where's the person that fact checked that? Because that sounds crazy to me.
It's true. I read a headline about an article about that too. I gotta be totally honest. I read a headline that said that, and I was like, I'll read that later. And I was like, or I'll just watch YouTube videos again that I've seen before. It was on NPR. Okay, Kazim was on NPR, so it means it's real.
Oh, yeah, if Terry Gross says it, it's real, you know what I mean? So we all know it.
No, it's true. I read the headline, like I said. What else? So let's do audience cards. Are there any more audience cards, Jeremy, because we went through that so quickly? Is there any more audience cards we got?
We have Ike Pinson.
Oh, we have the
audience.
Let's get to part two of that other card, of the Frisco 5 card. Again, sorry.
I'll just read it from the beginning.
Okay.
There's so much going on with me, it's difficult to know where to begin. I recently did a hunger strike to protest against police brutality in San Francisco, and it breaks my heart that although it was semi-successful, it took someone dying at the hands of law enforcement for action to occur. And still, every day, we see people murdered by officers, but we don't have enough people upset at the issue with blinders off. We need black, white, brown, yellow, red, and the like to fight the good fight. The struggle continues. Power to the people. Oh, P.S., I hope to one day be mayor of San Francisco.
Oh, is that what it says? No wonder. No wonder. Do you want to come down here and talk to us for a second and announce your candidacy? If we're going to do this, let's do this for real. That's right. Yeah, come on down here and let us know. Let the people know. Give it up, everybody. Thank you. Thank you for coming. And, sir, say your name again for the people.
Ike Pinkston.
Ike Pinkston. Come over here. Ike, give it up, Ike Pinkston. There we go.
Oh, what's up? Hey, what's going on? damn.
You're like from the black guy meeting. Yeah.
I ain't seen you on Tuesday, man. You know?
So talk more about what you're saying, and everybody can jump in on this about you saying, Ike, about how we need more people to be upset.
Well, I mean, I can be bluntly honest.
We are not on the radio no more. If you want,
cool.
Let them know.
There's not enough white people upset at black people dying. And
why do you think that is?
I think it is because a lot of white people are just comfortable with where they're at in life, Like, you have the whole white privilege thing going on. And if it's not in your back door every day, if it's not a part of your everyday life system, then you're going to brush it off. It's easy to brush it off than to just be like, oh, damn, you know, my next door neighbor's uncle's cousin died because he made a wrong turn into the wrong neighborhood, got pulled over, and then the next thing you know, he's dead. You know, what kind of bullshit is that? These are the people sworn to protect us. You know what I'm saying? And then people, and then the biggest rebuttal from white people is, well, what about the black on black crime? How the fuck are we gonna cure black on black crime if we can't even turn to the police officers who's supposed to arrest the people killing us?
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, absolutely.
And I'm tired of hearing that argument, because black on black crime is no bigger than white on white crime. It's no bigger than Latin American on Latin American crime. You know what I'm saying? So that's just a way for them not to feel.
It's a way to.
We actually had someone tweeting us about black on black crime earlier, Julius T. Crawford. I'm tired of hearing about black on black crime. What is black on black crime anyway?
It's all the things to derail the conversation that I think that people, that many white people like to get caught up in. Like, I remember that I talked about this in my act one time, about the idea that, like, when that teenage girl in South Carolina was thrown across the room by the cop, and there was like, well, people, and I had white friends of mine who were like, well, it's only a 15-second video, I need the whole story.
Yeah, like, why do you need to know what happened before?
Yeah.
You seeing what's happened right now, and you know it's not right. It doesn't matter. You know what I'm saying? And you're talking about the whole comply and obey. You know, if you just sit down on the curb, fuck that, I have rights.
Yeah.
Why do I need to sit on the curb? What is that doing? Yeah. How is that making you feel safe by me sitting on the curb? Okay, you know what I'm saying? It's ridiculous. And every time I watch, you know, Straight Outta Compton, and I see that one episode, and I see the cops making them all get on the ground, it's just like, it brings back that anger. That whole relatability.
There's something in human nature that it's missing, and it's called moral imagination. And it's really imagining that you yourself could be in that place. And that's what, in a way, keeps this divide. Because if you're from a certain community of a certain race, you don't imagine yourself being there. And what we need more of is this moral imagination, meaning imagine yourself there.
Right.
That's part of it. The other part is this. So there were people who had no interest in supporting gay rights, didn't touch their life, could care less, until someone in their family turned out to be gay. And then all of a sudden, they're the big supporters, because now they could relate.
Right.
There was something that happened. And so what is needed now more than ever is that moral imagination, being able to imagine yourself being in the skin of that person and experiencing that. And just along this line, I just want to say, this was before probably all y'all were born. When I was growing up, there was a strong, strong coalition between African Americans and Jews. And during the civil rights movement, it was blacks and Jews who marched together, who sacrificed and who died together. And that divide occurred really behind affirmative action. That's where the split started to happen. And I will tell you, I long for the day would come when African Americans and Jews could come together to lead this country like we did in the 50s and the 60s to bring this country together.
I just say sometimes I'm in the middle of the show watching and I forget, oh, this is actually the show I'm a part of. Like, I'm like, this is interesting. This is real good. I should write some of this down. I'm glad I came to this show tonight. This is having that moment right now.
I'm definitely glad I came. This is awesome.
I'm glad you came too. Look at you, bro.
Glad to see my boy. Yeah.
I did not know that was you, man. That's crazy.
You know, it's only a few black people in San Francisco. How could you not know it's me?
I think it's like. It is, man.
I've got jokes.
Basically, there's eight black people in San Francisco, so you go Frisco five. There's only three left over.
Okay.
Kasim didn't do it, so you know, I moved. There was Frisco nine for a while, but yeah.
Selassie lives in LA, so you say, by process of elimination. Cha-ching.
This is a good show. I'll say this about, the thing is, like you said, people didn't care about gay marriage judge, and you said until a member of their family, they found out it was gay. We need people to find out that a member of their family is black. I mean, and
or
I,
having I'm, sex with a black person.
Well, I mean, ta-da, my wife. So my wife is white, which meant that at some point her family found out, oh, we have a black member of the family, when I walked through the door with dreadlocks, didn't have a federal job at the time. And it definitely, that family has had more conversations about race than they ever had before I showed up. And I mean, that's like two conversations. You know what I'm saying, everybody? And so it has led to more conversations. I mean, I'm joking a little bit, three or four. Just because there was suddenly a reason that they had to be aware of who was in the room and what we were talking about. And also the things, you know, it's just, you can't talk the same way when you realize somebody's in the room representing that side.
Exactly. Yeah. There's no more elephant in the room when you bring the elephant home. I'm sorry.
Look, man, I put on some weight as a dad. You ain't got to be all body shaming me, brother. This is dad weight. I got dad bod. I'm proud of all this.
Hey, I put some back on.
I'm not going to make that joke. That's a funny joke, but I'm going to let that one lie. Do you have any other audience cards?
Yeah, I have one right here. There's no name on it. It says, why are we not talking more about Standing Rock and Native American people?
That's a good question. Give it up for Standing Rock. That's a good question. I will pimp my other podcast, Politically Reactive. Me and Hari Kondabolu had a podcast this week where we talked to an activist, Ben Alex Dupree, who was at Standing Rock, because we also felt like we need to be educated about Standing Rock. But yes, we should bring it into Kamau Right Now. Thank you. That's our next, we should do that next awkward conversation, White Max. He wants to say something. Let White Max speak.
White and Jewish Max.
That Jew's down with a black guy. Look at that, everybody.
Someone wants to know who booed when our Colin Kaepernick photo went up. Because we booed? Know they were in the crowd.
Oh, wait, Rhea Boyd is here, right?
I booed because he was getting so much crap over me.
She's like, let me be clear. Did you just throw up a black power fist, ma'am? Did I see that?
I know, right? She did. Like, I saw it a few times.
It came sideways like a jab, but it's still.
I was kind of concerned about the two people in front of her.
It was like a Bruce Lee punch, but still, we'll take it. Thank you for laughing at that. Try the pie if you want to get on this bean. You can talk too if you have something to say. Please do. Oh, well, okay. You're invited at any time, of course. My back is to you. Yeah, that was a good question. I'm glad we cleared that up. That'll be on the podcast, so good. I did think that was weird. I'm like, in this room? All right. Man, CNN goes everywhere. I get lots of new fans from all over the place. What else? There was a card, Jeremy, about, I remember you showed it to me, about I want to help somebody out, the card about the dress.
Oh yeah. I'm trying to find a plus-size wedding dress that doesn't look like a giant $2,000 meringue.
So who was that person who's trying to find the plus-size wedding dress? I mean, if you don't, you are too. Yes, okay, I'm coming. And I'm bringing a wedding dress with me. No, that's not true. Oh my God, I got asthma. All right. Hey, I know you. How are you doing? Good to see you.
I'm good.
Hey, tell the people who you are, Annalise.
Hi, I'm Suzanne.
I'm sorry.
Hello.
There
you
go.
Oh, I got another microphone. Okay, cool. Yeah, we've met before a few times.
We have met before.
Yeah.
I forgot your name.
Suzanne,
yes.
Yes.
I'm going to own
okay.
that. I'm going to own
it's okay.
How do I know you?
I think the porch light storytelling series.
Yes, okay. You said for a second, yes. I thought you were going to go, don't say Craigslist date. I have a history.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, my wife's listening to this.
No. We've
yes, porch
we've
light,
dated.
Yes. We did porch yes. light together.
Yes.
Okay, yes. Okay, so you're looking for a plus size wedding dress.
I am, or a dress to wear at my wedding. It doesn't even need
oh,
to be
so
a wedding dress.
Oh, I just realized this. I just thought like, okay, at your wedding.
Yeah.
My brain was not working. I was thinking like, wow, that's
generally
a big
what a wedding dress is.
You're right about that. I'm 0 for 2 right now, I'm owning it. When is your wedding?
Not for a year.
Wait, what's that? What?
That's what a lot of people have been saying, to have someone make it for me. Or one of my friends was like, it's really fun to make your own dresses. And I'm like, your kind of fun is not my kind of fun.
You're saying, yeah, you don't have to. You would like somebody to do all that work, and you just go, I'll take the third one, not
well,
the.
Well, it would be nice if, like, you could go into a store and buy a piece of clothing that fits you the way that other people can. You know.
When is your wedding? I don't remember if you told me.
Not until next, probably October. So I have a lot
of time. We have time. But, yeah. Well, I don't know. On wedding websites, they'll tell you, you're already behind.
Well, they'll just tell me to go on a diet or something, you know?
Oh, yeah. Everything's the worst.
Yeah, I know. It's okay.
So I'm opening it up to the room. We got a lot of smart people in here. We got hands. Okay, Shane's got an idea. You want to come down here with me and talk to Shane?
All right.
This is like an old school, like, no, it's a revival meeting mixed with Donahue. All right. I knew this room would be the perfect audience to make a Donahue reference. So Shane.
Yes.
No, you raised your hand. You put your hand.
Yes. The reason why I don't know something specific for you, but since my protest, a lot of really awesome fat activists have gotten in touch with me, and a lot of them do make clothes for beautiful, bigger women.
Yes.
And so there are options out there. Unfortunately, it isn't part of our culture to have that in the clothing stores.
Yes.
Even though it's the reality of our world, right?
Yeah,
that there's
absolutely
all these different beautiful bodies out there. But there are people who do that custom work. A lot of them.
So can you the way you sort of blew up our Kamau Right Now Facebook page, can you which honestly, thank you for doing that. We were like, oh, yes, we need to bring Shane here. Can you put us maybe figure if you can hook up some of these people to see if maybe put the word out, put the call out? Can we do that? All right. I mean, I can't guarantee anything. We're gonna put the call out.
That's right. And it's not just for me anyway. It's for anybody else in the same situation. This is for the world.
Yeah.
That's right.
Plus, in America, plus size is like a ridiculous. It's a category. It's called people size.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. All right. So that's good. So anybody else while we're doing over here we got somebody. I'm coming. Don't feel free to. Okay, I'm coming. Here you go.
I was just going to say ModCloth. They have awesome stuff. They have a huge plus-size department, and they have a lot of good wedding stuff. And their dresses are like $200.
eShakti has good options, too.
Oh, yeah, eShakti.
I have a very complicated relationship with both of those websites. Not going to get into it.
So the two websites we've said so far.
I bought a dress on eShakti. Sorry, I'm glad they're not like a sponsor of this podcast. Or
oh, but they're going to be next week. Don't say anything.
I tried on the dress and I'm like, huh, and I showed it to my boyfriend and he kind of made this face and he's like, huh. I'm like, does this...
Okay, that's a problem.
Yeah.
Part of getting married is learning not to make that face when women put on clothing. Or your partner puts on clothing.
He was being really good, but then I said, does this dress make me look like a prison guard? And he goes, oh my God, yes, you look like...
Oh, okay. These are two separate problems.
No, wait. It's better. He said, you look like
what, a formal
if
prison?
Shelley Winters played a prison guard in a movie.
Okay, all right.
And he was absolutely right, and I sent the dress back.
Is he here?
No.
Okay, all right. Can you send him to the next show? I need to talk to him, not during the show, but backstage about marriage rules 101. When your partner says, how does this make me look? You say, how do you feel? And if they go, I don't feel good, then you go, we're taking it back.
I want to know if I look like Shelley Winters playing a prison guard in a film. Like, I'm glad he said that because as soon as I was like, yeah, I see it. I totally see it. She's a wonderful actress. I think
yes.
She's really good.
Yeah, we're not trying to anyway. So we have two more people. There's one over here, but I saw this one put her hand up.
I was wondering looking for a traditional or a non-traditional dress.
Non-traditional. It doesn't even need to actually be a wedding dress.
There's a cool website called boohoo.com. Look it up, because they have a lot of full figures.
Wait, what is it, boohoo duck?
All right, I'll have to check it out.
I gotta admit, I'm not surprised that the black women would know where to find the good dresses for the, because what we call plus size and black, what white people call plus size, black people call this is just how our hips go. This is how.
Thank you.
All right, one more, and then we'll wrap this up. I love that we're ending on this. This is such a...
You're getting a lot of cardio today, man.
I am. It's good.
So I got mine on Dolly Couture, I think is the name of the website, .com. They're in L.A. They have a showroom in L.A. And it was gorgeous, and everybody loved it. So big shout out for Dolly. They have normal size, too, but the plus size was awesome.
Yeah, to be clear for people listening, you did do the fake quotes over normal size. You weren't actually saying that. It's like, they have normal size clothes. All right. Well, what do we got next? Where did my white Max go? I was looking for you. Is it? He went to sign his check over to Ike Pinkston.
We have someone who might be able to replace Max.
We do? Can
Maya
I join
Janelle.
Your
team? Can I join your team, Kamau, right now?
Maya Janelle?
I think they might be here.
Are you here? Oh, wait a minute. Hold on a second. Hold on. I'm going to do an interview, and then we're going to get out of here. Let's
awkward.
Do this. Maya Janelle. Is that your name, Maya Janelle?
Hi. Yes. Maya Janelle.
Where do you, here we go, you have your own microphone. Look, you already work on the team, you got your own microphone.
Awesome, thank you.
What do you do for a living?
I work for a real estate development company.
Okay, that's more qualifications than most of the people on my team have right now. would you like to work in radio, seriously? Or in...
Yeah, I'm trying to get into comedy, actually.
Oh, you're trying to get into comedy?
Yeah.
Okay, here's some advice. Don't do that. No, I'm just kidding. you're interested in more in comedy or more in radio? Like, do you want to work?
I like writing.
You like writing?
Yeah.
Okay. You have a full-time job with this realtor thing?
Yeah. Well, it's very 9 to 5, so I have a lot of free evenings and weekends.
Well, okay. How about this? How about we put you on staff for the next show?
Okay.
Which means you have to come to the next show.
Yeah.
We'll put you on staff. We will pay you. I don't know what people get paid here, but we will pay you something.
Minimum wage?
It'll be better than minimum wage. I refuse to do that. I'm going to play a woman of color minimum wage and feel like a person. feel like I'm doing my part for the community. Here's $7.25 an hour. Got to take out taxes. We'll talk to you about what, but we'll definitely come to the next show and you will help out and we'll start to learn the ropes of how this all works.
That sounds awesome.
So talk to Phil Circus over there. Phil Circus waving his hand. All right. Thank you to Maya Janelle, who's now works on the Kamau Right Now team.
Awesome.
Thanks to our panel. That's going to do it for us. Let's hear one more song to end the night. Give it up one last time for Try the Pie. Thank you, JCCSF. Thank you to the audience here. Thank you to my mom who's here. Give it up for Try the Pie.
After midnight and before sunrise, I get so hungry. It's a cold one, always a cold one when you're not around me. Dog at the window. Oh, I am always searching. My itchy.